Oh, right. I am recording again. It's been a while, but the Crunchcast is back again. And look, hey, there's John Jones. Haven't seen him in a while.
Howdy, howdy.
What's up, New York City?
Just getting it done. Focusing a lot on work and looking forward to the... at Avalanche Studios, we get a two-week vacation every summer. And that is at the end of this month. And I'm looking forward to it. Been building up to it.
Got any good plans, or...?
No. the only thing, mainly just want to like chill out at home and, you know, dick around with electronics and stuff.
Yeah, and you're in the city, so there's so much to do.
Oh God, totally. I actually will go outside. Man, it even occurred to me. Like I bought a Raspberry Pi at home, and I've been like fucking around with, you know, getting a media server going, and I've just been like dicking around with electronics. Every time I'm here, I'm like, oh, I'll fuck with this a little bit more. It's been kind of a fun, non-gamesy thing to do.
I'm so happy summer's here. I'm a summer kind of guy. The sun is still up, and it's 8 p.m. here. Holy crap.
And Denver's incredible.
Oh, yeah. You've seen our summers. You know.
Oh, man. Yeah, that one time. Things like September 3 or 4 years ago. Yeah. Stunning.
I mean, right now we're getting, like, tornado warnings every day, but it's only for a few minutes. But what does that have to do with video games? Nothing. Who cares about it? Nobody. What I kind of wanted to discuss on this episode was the topic of kind of why we do what we do, so to speak. As in, like, okay, we already have jobs and we have to work and do all this stuff, but why spend all this extra time doing tutorials? Tutorials. I got this weird audio thing where sometime I get like a slight delay. And have you heard of those audio jammers where it plays back what you're saying like a second later, so it makes you stumble up? I feel like I talk about this every time, so I'm just going to shut up. I know, like, why write tutorials? Why do all this extra stuff? What's the motivation behind all that? You know, for me, and you too, of course, but gosh, I think we're putting tutorials out for like, modifying Quake and the late 90s. So just been doing this kind of stuff for such a long time. And it's, for me, yeah. I've found I'm just a dummy. If I don't write it down, I'll forget it. So whenever I'm going through steps for something, I just write it down and put it in a little text file on my desktop. And every now and again, I'll open that up and be like, oh, wow, this looks useful. And kind of clean it up a little bit, maybe put some pictures in there, and then just post it. They write themselves because of all the writing I have to do. How about you?
I remember you doing that. I mean, in the late 90s, you'd always like be writing tutorials or like putting notes together and just trading notes and stuff. I'd be surprised if you published like a tenth of what you'd written down. And that's
an amazing thing. If you saw my docs folder right now, it's just full of questionable content. Like, you open it, but what is this even about? And it's just weird shorthand kind of notes.
Dude, I have the same thing. At work, I write everything down. I found a version, like a notepad type text editor that lets me have a crap load of files open all at once really easily. So I always have like 10 or 15 things. I have like my docs folder just for work is like probably a couple thousand text files of shit I've just jotted down like that, just because, you know, like you, I've gotten the habit of it over the years. I mean, if it isn't written down, it's not real.
Yeah. Well, I had a lead that would come by every day for like what we call dailies. And when he'd start talking, I'd say, oh, we go, whoa, slow down. Let me write that down. And it always made him happy. He's like, you're the only one that writes down my notes. This is great. I'm like, well, otherwise I'm just going to forget it like everybody else. I think your portfolio repels jobs. I think that might have been like the initial origin of it all. I mean, we did tutorials and stuff before, but we had reached that point where we were both working and we were both dealing with putting out, you post a job offer somewhere and you get this inbox just full of emails. And it's just, okay, I got a couple dozen portfolios to review in the next 10 minutes because I still have to do my job. And our idea was, why are all these portfolios so poorly put together or so random and different and terrible, hidden content? So you just kind of took a bunch of the things that we talked about and organized it properly. And the idea is like, hey, let's just set the formula, set the base so everybody's doing this so that when we have to post jobs later, all these portfolios are nicely laid out like we want to see them.
Yeah, exactly. Like, we've been in those guys' positions before, and it's just like, oh, God. You know, like I that kind of thing wouldn't upset me. Well, not that it really upset me, but if I was really and truly annoyed by portfolio, the ones that annoyed me the most were things that I'd done before and didn't realize it.
Oh, sure.
Just like, oh, God, I wish I'd, you know, I wish I'd known that, or I wish someone had said that. And I mean, your portfolio repels jobs was like the culmination of, like, 8 years of just you and me talking, like, every day for, God, like, 8 hours.
Hey, look at this portfolio somebody sent me today. That kind of stuff. We still do that. Just like, what, last week or so, I sent you one? I was like, dude, you gotta see this portfolio. This guy's art is great. This site is garbage. Some site, I swear, I think it autoplayed music. His image just came up full size, and then would do, like, a weird, like, shatter, like, breakaway fade into the next image. You couldn't just click on it and look at it? It's so annoying. It's horrible.
And just because you can doesn't mean you should. And, dude, Wix has commercials now.
Yeah, I saw. I was like, oh, no.
They're the Photoshop of portfolio hosts. Or, sorry, the Photoshop lens flare portfolio hosts. Just fucking... I heard they're like a $68 million company. Just don't. Yeah, this is just the kind of shit that, you know, we've done it, we've seen it, it's just sort of like a, you know, you cringe a bit, but we want to do something about it. And plus, by writing these things down and, you know, like, putting them in order and publishing them, and instead of just having notes just for me, like, oh, well, I'll remember this shit, or I'll remember what this shorthand means, or whatever, like, forcing ourselves to, you know, put our words together in sequences that make sense to other people, not just in our shorthand, helps really clarify the ideas, at least for me. It helps me organize my thinking and understand, like, kind of how to communicate, and it drives home to me whatever I'm trying to write about. So it's not really just me bitching, it's like trying to explain what I think is good or bad and what could be done better, because I don't know, like, kind of like training and educating myself as I go as well.
I mean, it's not really real great comparison, but say you're trying to build a house. You don't build the foundation right, the support structures right, whatever. It's just going to collapse upon itself. That's a bit more drastic than a portfolio, but look at it this way. Your career will collapse upon itself because that's your end. Your portfolio is your baseline. That and your resume, of course. But I feel like I'm getting a little off track there with as to why we do this. And the first reiteration there is we just got tired of seeing all the same problems. It's just over and over. So why sit there and do nothing when you can write an article that helps people out? And your articles have been hugely popular for God knows. I still link it to people all the time. And I think you wrote it in, what, 2005 or something like that?
Yeah, 2005.
It's craziness, man. It's insanity. And I've said so many times, I'm like, who is the person out there? Who's the teacher? What school? Where is this person at that tells people to do everything so wrong? Because it's not that you're seeing new problems. It's always the same problem, just coming back, like a flash site or whatever. So yeah, you need to hunt down this person.
It still holds. But yeah, like when I check my website stats, I don't think I've gotten like less than 100 hits a day on that in 9 years. I mean, and that's usually kind of like the baseline, unless there's a big surge of traffic or something. It's kind of wacky seeing it like that, because from the very beginning, like, everything I've ever written or blogged about to try to help other people, like, the way, like, my audience and the kind of person I was like trying to focus on was just me in the past. What would I have loved to have heard at this juncture? Like, if I write an article about a portfolio, thinking, like, okay, when I'm putting together my first portfolio, what the hell do I just need to hear? And then I, you know, I focus it on that in hopes that, you know, something that I really care about, or something, someone like me, they're doing something they really care about and they're aspiring to have a career being creative and passionate about something. I want that, you know, something will maybe trigger with them that makes sense, that will help them do better in their career and kind of, you know, build what they want from their life through their own effort and persistence. I mean, that's a beautiful thing.
Oh yeah. And outside of just portfolio stuff, man, I don't know. You seem to go more business side, but I still like to do a lot of the art tutorial stuff. And I always get a lot of good feedback about that. I really think it's cool when people want to help others. You've got to, just going to put this out there, you got to be careful before you tell people how to do something. If you haven't done it before yourself, or if you just learned it that day, sort of the,
if you're learning it, write it.
What's that?
Or if you're learning it as you're writing it.
Yeah. There was a guy way back that used to write a bunch of tutorials, and all of his tutorials were written in a style that I called the gunshot effect. As in, if you were just shot, you know, nowhere critical, like in the leg or something, and it hurts really bad, and ow, I'm bleeding, and I need help. All his tutorials were written at that point in life, as opposed to years later, after he's healed and rehabbed and can really look back on it and give you some real advice. That's how everyone was written. It was just like, okay, I see you just learned how to do this. Here's how you really do it.
It's like a gunshot victim that just got shot explaining how not to get shot.
Yeah, or explaining the healing process. It's just not, the information is just not there. It's incomplete.
It's like, let it bake.
Yeah. I just learned how to weld these two vertexes. I'm going to make a tutorial.
On patch modeling.
I worked at a place one time. We would do this thing where some of the top, like, better guys would do, like, big studio presentations where they'd just do tutorials. Like, oh, here's how I paint my concepts. And it was always awesome. But then one day, we're doing it, and it was like kind of between a couple guys. So the actual art director got up there and started talking. And he's one of those ADs that probably did art at some point in his career, but now he's just living his life and meeting hell. And it's just so behind.
Described like art directors.
Oh, yeah, yeah, pretty much. He started like trying to give his own little art tutorial. And as you, like every other step, somebody in the crowd would yell out, actually, you do it like this now. That's from the old Photoshop. In new Photoshop, it's like this. It was kind of funny / sad, because you always feel bad for the guy, but he's the one doing the talking.
It's like, look, sir, you're airbrushing a mod, or you're using an actual airbrush on a mod, or how old are you?
Yeah. And there was this one guy, he posted on Polycount, gosh, a year or two ago? Like some huge video series. It was like 48 hours of hour-long videos or something. So it was a playlist of something like 100 videos that were an hour long. It was ridiculous. And all it was modeling. Just no finished asset or anything, just modeling. And everything he was doing was wrong. The way he was making topology was wrong. The way he was explaining it was wrong. It was just bad news. And everybody told him, but he, whatever. So what are you going to do about that? Anyway, that was my 5-minute aside of, before you start writing tutorials and helping people out, make sure you know what the fuck you're talking about.
See, that's one of the things I love about doing the Crunchcast with you, is like that came up because you and I had been chatting about that earlier. This is like stuff that comes up on a day-to-day basis. It's just like, oh, check out this shit. Like, oh my god, that's ridiculous. And then, you know, like there, it bubbles out.
Oh, yeah. And, I mean, you got to be careful out there, because how are you going to compete with, like, the real sites, like 3D Total or Eat3D, all those major sites that have, you know, real good information, they're actually good enough to sell?
Yeah.
You got to be careful, man. Yeah.
Exactly. Like, I'm not going to invest 48 hours in something I... No, it's going to make a really, really raunchy joke. If I'm going to invest 48 hours in focusing on something someone's doing, they're either going to be extremely attractive and naked, or a total badass artist.
Oh yeah, no one's gonna sit through that many hours of a tutorial. You're not learning anything. You could sit there, you could give a kid 3D Studio Max, open it up, and say, "Here, just go." And within 48 hours, he'd be better.
Or
just
dead.
Sitting there watching this video. Speaking of things, that's the 15-minute mark. I'm actually making soup, and I need to stir it. So, John, if you want to take the wheel for just a minute here.
Actually, yeah, real quick, I gotta
go use the restroom. Oh. Oh, you go ahead. Then I'll just keep talking.
Okay.
Or we're going to pause it.
Let's just go ahead and pause it.
Okay. Okay, quick break there. If only we had commercials to put in that. So yeah, the topic is about, you know, why we do this crap anyway. And we just reviewed a bit about tutorials and whatnot. Why am I even giving you a recap? If you're listening to this thing as one, there's no point.
let's put a video of a cat in there.
Yeah.
Or like an animated GIF of a cat, like five or six loops, like a fat cat falling off a couch or something.
Yeah. Like, you know, one of those cat has like a costume on and it just falls over? One of those things?
It's like, I won't try.
So can you think of, what was the first tutorial you ever wrote? I can kind of think of mine. I'm pretty sure it was some little Photoshop thing or something, or like PaintShop Pro, and how to get nice edges using selections, masks, and whatnot.
Oh my god, I don't even remember what my first one was. I know I read a hell of a lot. I mainly only remember like the kind of outsourcing and, you know, sort of businessy, self-improving kind of stuff, just because that's more recent.
Right. So, well, with that in mind, have you got anything coming up? Anything big?
Yeah, I'm actually I'm working on a talk that I'm shopping around to conferences, talking about how to untether yourself physically from any location and make the freelancing easier through tools and technology. Like the specific software you need, the discipline and techniques you'll need to be able to, you know, keep up with your workload and keep up and manage your clients, but also have like the specific electronics and gadgets and whatnot you need to be able to pick up and go and be ready to be online and connected and doing your thing from anywhere in the world. And like getting down to like even, you know, like the travel adapters, the software, the web-based services, just everything you need to be able to be like a mobile freelancer with everything in a bag. I'm still kind of fleshing that out. I'm excited about it.
You know, I sent you that link earlier about Jim Norton filming his show in New York.
Oh,
tickets
shit, yeah.
Are sold out now, but so too late, bitch. He just restarted his advice show, and they set up the microphone and a laptop kind of set up in his apartment or his house or whatever, so he doesn't have to go into the studio. It's pretty cool.
That's awesome. It's amazing what you can do remotely. I mean, when I ran my company, Smartest, I mean, I was a freelance outsourcing manager, and I traveled all over and got to do what I wanted from wherever. Like, I went to Seattle for 3 weeks once just for a show. So I had to work out of coffee shops. But I learned, you know, how to stay motivated and focused, and also how to always make sure I have a power outlet or a way to connect to the internet or, you know, back up this or emergency that in security tools and tech. I'm getting stuff at work, so I'm kind of stoked.
You know,
something going.
Sorry, got a little garbly there. You know, if you watch things like sports or anything, a few years back, if they ever did the interview with somebody, if they couldn't come in the studio, they had to send like a camera out to them, maybe a green screen or something, like a curtain behind them, and they get all like makeup and put on a suit and all that. Now you'll see interviews on like Fox Sports Live or whatever, and the guy's just got an iPad. He's just holding up, looking into it in his room, talking to him over like Skype or Google Hangout or whatever.
It's amazing.
There's just it's kind of like flying in planes, you know? Back in the old days, people put on their Sunday best. Now, just when you go fly on a plane, you put on pajamas and bring a blanket. The convenience things, you know, it's Maybe yeah, risk and poor, you know, and rich.
Put on your most farted in pants to go on the airplane.
Yeah. Now if you're going to get on a plane, you just put on sweatpants and pop a Cialis.
That's why we don't travel together.
So as far as like, so that's what you're working on. I've got a few myself. I'm still dealing with art. And I've gotten into this Unreal 4 lately, since that's out. And it's pretty cool.
Oh, God, yeah. I'm so excited.
The whole like crowdsourced kind of Unreal tournament for. I've just gotten started with stuff, and I don't even want to show anything off or talk about it, because it's just like I said, the gunshot effect. I need a lot more time just tinkering around before I feel comfortable telling anybody anything about it, even though most of the stuff is the same as it was in UDK. But really looking forward to what that's going to give us.
They're totally. And I know how you get when there's new tech. I mean, you just go just crazy intense on just noodling with it, no matter what it is.
Oh, yeah. I just sit up like all night opening assets and looking at them. I'm like, that's how you do that. Yeah. But this new one, man, the Unreal Engine 4, have you seen it?
Not up close. I've seen some of the videos and some of the summaries, but I haven't.
Because what I mean is like actually what it looks like on your computer when you start it up. It's very cool. Like it's a subscription service. Everybody's heard that. But when you actually launch it, it has kind of like a front end, kind of like Steam. Like say you're gonna play a game on Steam, but you go to Steam and you can see the store and you can see this other stuff and you can see all your other games and you pick which one you want to launch. It's really nice. You fire it up and you see all the content that you can already download for free or possibly purchase down the road. But right now, there's all kinds of examples like this. Elemental demos. There's a blueprint examples. You just have to see. There's so many examples. It's stunning. The amount of, I would say, what do you say, like pre-production work, I guess?
Yeah. Like,
it's not fully a thing yet, but there's so much already there. Imagine in a year from now how amazing it's going to be. How much content the users are going to make, like their own tutorials and stuff. It's going to be great.
I'm really excited. I mean, Unreal, like a UE4 going subscription, CryEngine going subscription, and even a more competitive price. I mean, it's freaking crazy. I think, yeah, over the next year or two, it's only going to get more and more nuts. And has CryEngine announced if they're going to do like an asset marketplace kind of thing?
I don't have the answer.
So I'd be curious. I'm surprised they didn't have something like that in the works, because I think Unity had a terrific idea with their asset marketplace. It's great seeing UE4 doing the same thing. Like, I think that, I mean, I think it'd be a great opportunity now, especially but moving forward into the future, for people that are, you know, between jobs or even just like newly ground with art. Off hours or just little things to augment your income as a freelancer. If you could put together, you know, quality enough assets in like themed packs and stuff and sell them on there, that could be a nice little, you know, sideline supplemental income. I strongly recommend artists that are, well, good enough to get their stuff sold and package it as a theme people will want. Highly recommend doing that.
Oh, yeah. I've got friends that are making all kinds of money now. I'm like, geez, I got to get in on this. I remember back, when Unreal 3, the engine, or Unreal Tournament 3, the collector's edition, it came with like a bonus DVD, and it had the editor, and it had all of these videos explaining how to do basically everything, and of course they had all the UT3 content that you could go through and look at all of it, and at the time I was like, wow, this is the best, it's not going to get better than this, and then UDK came out, I was like, okay, just download it for free, whatever. We've got all this documentation, all this community. It's like, wow, it's not going to get better than this. Now this UE4 thing, like I said, the whole marketplace, the whole everything being integrated into like one nice little system where people can publish their stuff either for free or, like I said, a little bit of monetization. It's quite nice.
It's a great time to be alive. I mean, the only way they could really top that is if Mark Rain personally installs your copy of UE5 on every device you own. It's like the only.
they send Jordan Walker to your house, and he trains you for a week. That would be awesome. Actually, we worked in CryEngine for the game Nexus. Crytek sent out three people to stay with us for like a week, just trained us all week. It was awesome. That kind of those kind of services for people that purchase the engine. That's just awesome. Love that stuff.
Oh, it's amazing. Those Crytek guys are crazy, crazy smart. I haven't had a chance to play with their tech.
It's pretty nice. And yeah, they're smart and really cool guys. I at some point I'm like, man, I should get a gig like that. They just travel all around the world. Like whatever company licenses their engines and they just go train people up on it.
I think you could easily do that.
Maybe.
Like just update your LinkedIn, just change your headline to just like a short one sentence version of doing that and see what happens.
Yeah.
No, seriously, I really think you could successfully do that and make money at it.
Probably. I keep wanting to do something like just go into not full time teaching, but maybe something like on the side, get a little extra money here and there.
Oh, totally.
I'm not struggling, but just like I said, like enjoy teaching, writing tutorials, helping people out. So why not get a little bit more of a personal touch and get a couple of dollars out of it?
Exactly. And there are a lot of companies that are starting up wanting to do like paid career services and like online learning resources and like game dev boot camps and stuff like that. And there's starting to be some money in that and getting that kind of thing together. There's a lot more interest, like especially from the academic side of things.
The WWE, the wrestling company, they recently, well, in the last year, they made the Performance Center, and they kind of teamed up with Full Sail University. So people that want to get into like media and stuff, working cameras, all the behind the scenes of entertainment, television, stuff like that. They've got a full studio set up, and people can get direct experience basically working for their wrestling shows. And the people that are the talent, the actual wrestlers, what are you doing?
Oh, sorry.
Sitting there like solving a Rubik's Cube?
No, I peeled off
Oh, you're sitting there just tinkering with your...
Sorry.
What an asshole.
Well, no, yeah, I wasn't thinking about it. But no, they're getting to... Fuck,
they're also trading the wrestlers up on things like, okay, life after wrestling. Like, what's your... You gotta have a college degree. You gotta have something planned out. And they do this other... There's this other program I've heard they're getting a part of. It's called Hired Heroes, where it's like ex-military people. They train them up like how to write a resume, like little things like that, like how to get, you know, back into society.
Oh, that's awesome.
And that's, you know, beyond video games, but I'm like, man, that's great. That's something I could get into.
No, absolutely. I mean, fulfilling a need and stuff that people can be better at that's helpful and positive for them.
Yeah. It's just, it just goes back to just helping people out.
I keep doing it because I can only imagine if you didn't want to help people, I know all this energy would go to something probably really scary.
Right. Yeah.
You just randomly like show up maternity wards and like rearrange all the babies' little like wrist straps from the newborns.
Release a lion into a hospital. You see, people can't get away because they're all strapped to beds and things.
The police can't figure out where you keep getting different lions. Anyway.
Where's all these lions coming from? Mexico?
Yeah, the Mexican lion.
Well, you know.
The Latin American tragedy.
Actually, I heard that there's now a population of hippos. I think in South... can't talk. Somewhere in South America because... Who was the major judge? I think it was the Pablo Escobar. I'm messing this up. Just look it up. But apparently, there's a population of hippos down there in the rainforest now because after he was caught or killed or whatever, all his like he had this zoo, a personal zoo, because the dude was rich.
Yeah, I think he was. I think it was the first drug billionaire.
Yeah.
And that's my God. I mean, if you have, I remember hearing about I mean, something along those lines, like a private zoo is just like, fuck it. So there are all these like cocaine hippos wandering around. And that's the worst kind of animal to have wandering around.
Cocaine hippos.
Well, hippos in general, but especially cocaine hippos.
Because they're all coked out. They're all jittery. Yeah,
the two deadliest
jittery
animals.
Jittery and defensive.
Or mosquitoes and cocaine hippos.
Yeah. It's kind of like that whole, after the Hurricane Andrew in Florida, when it hit that, hit all those snake farms. They were just destroyed, and now there's all these pythons in Florida.
Oh my god.
I mean, we see pictures of that all the time online. A giant python killed by a crocodile that he ate. It's ridiculous. Has nothing to do with helping people.
Florida should change their state motto to the look at us and feel better about yourself state.
Just change it to like, fuck this. I got an email recently, and some young lady just looking for advice getting into games, and that was one of the things I told her was, you know, document your process, write it down. If it comes out good, you can share it with others, and you're going to end up helping more people in the long term, and then they're going to remember you for that. They're going to like you. I mean, whoa, is that a siren?
Yeah. Anyway. My god, this is a sensitive microphone.
It is. Sometimes it picks things up. What are you going to do? Anyway.
I think there's some shit going on up the road.
Nice.
Someone got murdered at my bus stop on Monday. Or my train stop.
Well, that happens.
Yeah. That's not helping people.
Hey, you're in the city. What are you going to do? I mean, it just goes back to that thing I would just say. Just help people out. It's almost, to me now, it's weird when someone thanks me for something. I'm like, I get a little weirded out for them when someone's like, oh yeah, if it wasn't for you, I'd have never got into games. I'm like, that's weird. I don't know how to take the feeling, you know?
Oh, totally. Like, I get, like, appreciative email, and, like, I guess you could call it fan mail and stuff from time to time, and I always, you know, try to reply when I can, but sometimes I just don't know how to, like, deal with it.
Yeah, and to be cordial, I guess, but...
Yeah. But just like, okay, cool.
I
don't care. It's like, oh yeah, people read this.
Yeah, and it's really common, like, especially with younger talent. Like, they're just not prepared for, you know, real feedback. And some say, oh, that's, you're being too harsh, you're being too rude. I'm like, no. You know what's harsh and rude? When your employer says you stink and you're fired. That's harsh and rude. I'm nothing to that. I'm just somebody on the internet saying, hey, the color of those bricks just ain't right. And, go ahead.
And if the color of the bricks isn't right, it isn't right. Like, I once had, this was a long time ago, and I won't name the company, but I once had a senior art director guy that was not overseeing my project directly, but kind of reviewing projects. He was a dickhead, but he told me in a meeting once, if this game fails, it'll be because of you. And I kind of try to live my life in such a way that I never have to hear those words ever again. And he was wrong. It failed for completely unrelated reasons.
Yeah, have you ever actually been in a case where that was true? Like, not you, but I mean, you were on a game and it failed, and you know exactly why and who it was. I can think of at least one.
I don't know if I could put the blame on any specific individual, at least not that was internal. Like, if there's like a publisher or some kind of external dependency or something like that, I can sort of see it as like, you know, these decisions made by this body caused this to happen, but I don't think I could pinpoint a total failure to just one person.
Sure. I mean, it's tough to put it all on somebody, but when they're in a certain position to make certain decision, and you know for a fact, okay, this guy made this decision, and every review I read says this game sucks because of this. Hey, most of the time, yeah, the art's good, animation's nice, looks pretty, whatever. Hey, the programmers did their job. But maybe some crazed designer or the president of the company just had to step in and change something. I don't make games anymore, but I pay for them.
And I have opinions, so I can feel involved.
By God, I know that this gear is what turns this gear, which makes the whole thing work. But I've got this wrench, and I think it goes right here. I've heard stories of guys that were, their nickname at the company was Wrench.
Yo. I like that. I've definitely worked with people like that before.
Well, I've had plenty of wrenches. Actually, weirdest thing, I worked on a game where somebody had this bright idea, because they were the boss, we had to do it, to like totally change a room I had to make, which totally changed the design. It was a boss fight room. And I'm like, no, let's change all this like this. It'll be easier. Which, of course, it was another week of work just for me. And then the designers totally had to redo the boss battle, because it didn't make sense anymore based on the way they changed the room. It's just annoyances. But let's stay back on topic. Yeah.
We're a little rusty, folks.
Yeah, I was just saying, like, that whole, when people get mad about feedback, I posted on Facebook a few weeks ago about some kid just going crazy because of some feedback I gave him, because it was, he made a level and it was broke. It didn't work. Yeah, no, had absolutely no optimization. The whole level rendered the whole time, and it was just covered in particles everywhere, and collision was broke. You get stuck on everything, to which you reply, it's supposed to. Go ahead.
How rude of you.
Yeah.
Pointing out technical faults.
Yeah. And it had, like, I think probably the biggest fault of all was it was supposed to be a deathmatch map. And he made all the spawn spots in this one little location. So if you died, you respawned here. Always. There were several spawn points, so multiple people could die and respawn there. So technically, you could just stay there, camp it, kill everybody as they spawned. Or, if you kill somebody, you know exactly where they're going to spawn. And they had to hit a jump pad to fly back into the level. And when you're in a deathmatch map, a little technical talk here, folks. Jump pads are great, but what they do is they leave you vulnerable in air, because you're flying through the air in a predetermined destination. And you can't do anything. I mean, you can shoot, you can fight back, but you can't move. Everybody that sees you flying through the air knows exactly your trajectory, how fast you're going, where you're going, all that. So essentially, you just pick up whatever sniping type rail weapon, kill somebody, and just point it at the spawn spot and wait. As soon as they respawn, shoot them dead. Shoot them dead. There was nothing they could do. It totally broke. And when I explained it to him, he's like, well, I didn't want this for people that really play good. It was funny. But, you know,
interesting market.
So the follow-up to that was how I still get emails all the time from people that they'll link me a thread or something. I've totally forgot it. It's like some random post I made. And they'll apologize for what they said. And they go, like, you know, it takes a year later, right? But they realize, oh, yeah, I get it now. The gunshot effect. A year later, it makes sense. Because now you understand how it works.
Yeah, it takes a certain level of not just maturity and learning, but humility. And I've never known you to... I've rarely known you to be unnecessarily harsh. Like, I mean, you just lay it right the fuck out there.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's like, I don't say, hey, this is bad, you're ugly, and your mother dresses you funny. I'm not actually insulting the person, but what a lot of people do is, when they make art, they take it personally. They take it as a personal attack. It was something I learned in one of my first office jobs, was I worked with guys that they just weren't prepared for professional dialogue. And when I brought up how the characters could be improved, the guy that was making the characters, like, went into tears and ran out of the room.
I'm right here.
I was like, to me, it seemed like insanity.
Yeah.
Like, you're that attached to this piece of art because you've only done it once or twice. You know how many textures I've made? I've made thousands of textures for just individual games. So if I make one texture and it's ugly, I don't care. I'm not attached to that thing. But like I said, when you're just inexperienced and, you know, you're immature as an artist, not like your personality. I mean, like, as in, you want to start making cars. The first car you make is going to stink, and you're going to be a little bit personally attached to it. But after you've made a few dozen cars, anybody can say whatever they want, and you're like, whatever, I'm just going to delete this anyway.
Yeah, I mean, it's... Actually, I'd never really thought about it like that. And just in terms of, you know, when you're starting out new, you don't have a very big body of work.
Yeah, it's just numbers. It's like quantity after a while.
Yeah, like if you've only ever, like, made five things, so one of those five things is just crap. That's like 20% of everything you've ever made sucks. And Chris, how many textures have you worked on in your career?
I couldn't tell you, but like I said, I know... Right. Go ahead.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you just got to get used to, you know, the process of, you know, churning this out, doing this, creating it something for a purpose instead of thinking, you know, I'm only as good as my last piece. Instead of letting that be a reflection of how good you are, just, I don't know, I'm kind of going off on that tangent, but I've learned to find joy in process, not in more so than product to some extent. So as long
it's
as
a journey,
I'm, you
not
know,
a destination.
Exactly. Like, I just try to be good at what I'm doing and get better at doing that. And, you know, if I'm keeping, you know, if I'm getting my engine's oil checked and, you know, regular maintenance, and I'm sure that's running pretty cleanly, whatever, you know, whatever the product is going to get better and better on its own. So I'm more investing in, like, my own skills and my means of applying them than the, you know, I'm only as good as this piece of art.
Yeah. I mean, it's not just our industry. It's...
Sorry.
God bless you. I'd say it's everything. Everywhere you go. I've done a lot of different things in life. I remember, like, you're talking about an engine or, like, working on a car. I've seen, like, young guys get mad at saying, oh, yeah, don't do it like this, do it like this. And they'll get mad because they just... Look, I've changed 1,000 car tires, and this is your second. You're getting mad at me for what I'm telling you? We had the same stuff like when I did wrestling school. We'd have guys, new guys, and you'd start telling something, and they get a little like they're taking it personally. I'm like, dude, you haven't even had a match. Or like a guy's like, you haven't even shipped a game, and you're getting mad at what someone is telling you? I think it's kind of a form of insanity, but I'm not a psychologist. So if you tell me anything about psychology, I'm going to take it personally.
you looped back to that one nicely.
Oh, yeah. The callback, so yeah.
You got to learn to have tougher skin. And to a great extent, I mean, that's why we talk and write and teach and stuff. I mean, like, we don't have time to fuck around or bullshit, and that's why, you know, we're right to the point, and we talk about how it is as we see it, having worked in games, having seen this 1,000 times, having worked with people for so many years. Like, you're in games, what, like 15 plus years now?
Oh, yeah. 17, unless you count the times I was laid off. Then I think the total is like 12.
I mean, 17 years ago you started.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm
1997, first ship.
Nice. That's crazy.
Getting old, bro.
Falling 17. Apart. Yeah, I'm... Damn. And I'm actually... Yeah, fuck, I have a milestone birthday coming up. You've known me a while.
Yes, I have. But yeah, it's one time. Sometimes when people just ask for advice, I just go right to an anecdote. Like I said, just tell them a story. Like, so it was a recent Reddit post I did where someone was asking about things in games, and it went over very well because I didn't really get specific, but I just said, well, here's a few things that has happened to me. I just told these crazy stories that if someone told you, they'd be like, no way that happened. That's insane. But that's games, man. That's just people. People are insane. And you're going to run into them in your life. The older you get, the more you're going to run into. So
yeah,
sometimes a little anecdote helps.
Oh, totally. It's fun. I mean, we work with lively, quirky characters. Like I worked with a guy that had a t-shirt that he would wear regularly of Sharon, that moment from Basic Instinct, I think it was, where Sharon Stone is uncrossing her legs. He has a t-shirt with that captured on it, and damn it, I wish he hadn't walked away, because I wanted you to hear that. But yeah, we work with a quirky, lively cast of characters, and one of the reasons I love to, you know, write and blog and help people and stuff is, I don't know, I like it here. I have fun, and I like that working with people in games, the one thing that we all have in common is you don't end up in games accidentally. You had to earn your way there, and you had to focus on something and really apply yourself. In working in games, your work, like every single person you work with, generally speaking, has passed that barrier and made something enough of themselves that they moved into that field. That's a super cool thing to have in common with people.
Yeah. You know, I've said that same thing to a lot of people when it's, you know, like I said, since I've been in games so long and I'm so cool, a lot of times, a lot of times I kind of have to be like a cornerstone or like the advice guy for the young people at companies. Like when they're like freaking out about something, I go, oh, no. Let me tell you what's a real bad situation. Say all that's happening and you're not being paid, or, you know, like little things. People don't know how good they have it sometimes. And like you said, I've done a lot of other things, other little jobs, other little fun stuff and whatnot in my life. And you realize in video games, yeah, these are people that are so skilled, no matter how crazy or annoying they might seem, they were still skilled enough to get this far. Versus like, okay, you go, oh, I'm going to go find a martial arts school or something. And there's some young people there that can't hold a job at like a grocery store. And just basically, when they were born, they were dipped in dumb as shit sauce. And they never got over it. Yeah, you're young, you're immature and whatever, but they just, you realize, okay, this person doesn't have the ability to listen. Or this person can't improve at all. It's just, it seems weird to say, like, oh, no, everybody has a skill. It's like, no, a lot of people are dummies. And if you want proof, just go, get a job at Walmart and deal with those people. You know, find something that doesn't really take any skill. Hang out with them for a while. You'll get dumber just being around some folks.
I've worked at both Walmart and Target. I agree.
Yeah, like I said, you're still surrounded by skilled people. People that are able to hold what you call a career. Quit fumbling.
Sorry.
God, who are you, my brother?
But yeah, they're skilled, they have a career, and I like helping people that can, you know, help join the club.
Sure, sure. I feel like it sounds a little rude, kind of the way I worded that, but it's just how it is. Some people just aren't, they just don't have this basic cognitive ability to either hold a regular conversation, or I find myself doing this a lot. Like, I have different groups of circles and friends, and certain ones are, they treat certain things in a certain way, and then every once in a while I have to go like, what are you talking about? That doesn't make any sense. And just kind of, you know, like explain like how a law works or how mortar supports bricks, you know, like weird little things you have to explain to people. I don't know.
Did that mortar thing actually happen?
Maybe.
That'd be a weirdly.
I don't know. It's like I said, there's some things that people get like to get attached to an idea and just stick with it, as opposed to, I take more of a scientific approach, that here's a few things I think and like to believe, but if I learn otherwise, I'm like, oh, that's fascinating, and I'm glad I learned otherwise. I'm not upset about it. Silliness, John.
Oh, totally. I mean, do you want to do something to be good at it, or do you want to do something and feel good about doing it?
Yeah, I heard that recently. Do you want to actually, do you want to do the hard work? The dedication, the time it takes to make sure you're doing something right, the best way? Or do you want to find a bunch of shortcuts to say, oh, this is easy to do and I can get a result?
Yeah, exactly.
What the hell is that? Anyway, it's... Eh. What am I talking about, John?
But, yeah, it's just about emotional gratification at that point. But, I've always been happy if, any of the advice that, I've given other people, they've been able to practice and turn into something helpful for them and help them be, have the, work in the same field that I do, that I enjoy so much. And I mean this half jokingly, if the things that I write about, saying this is the right way to do something, this is a good way to do something, if enough people do that, in a funny way, I'm sort of making sure I have more capable people of eventually working with one day.
Oh, sure. You're kind of like building talent. That was, for some reason, while you were talking there, I was reminded by three stupid stories. It's like, if you want to see a good view, if you want to see... Gosh, I didn't think it was that funny.
No, that was just an amazing statement. Oh, while you were talking, I was thinking of... That reminded me of three stupid stories.
That's just how my brain works, sorry. I get up and walk into the kitchen, and I'll think of eight things that I should be writing down. But if you want to see a beautiful view, you can look out your window. Or you can hike up to the top of a mountain. Which is going to be a better view? Top of the mountain, probably. It's I forgot how that one story went. It was something there was a bug. And the bug hated its life because it was always it lived in a carpet. And life was tough because it had to always get through this carpet and all this annoyingness. But the bug never knew that it actually was living in the most beautiful carpet ever made. It's just its perspective. It was always focused on its own troubles of being in the carpet, not realizing how beautiful it was.
Yeah, I mean, it pays to take a step back and look at everything as a whole.
The road less traveled.
Yeah, whenever I get really stressed out at work or something, and just start getting really down, what often helps kind of bring me back is just reminding myself what I do is fun. Jesus Christ, I get paid to make video games. It's shit ain't that bad.
Yeah, imagine if you were born in Uganda or something.
Oh.
I'm kind of in that same way, but I'll just take a walk. I'll take my key to the house, put it in my pocket, and that's it. Just go take a walk. Go to the park, just walk. I don't need a phone in my hand. Just kind of absorb life for what it is. Let's pontificate further about horse shit.
But no, I've actually done a similar thing that's helped clear my head. Just at work, I'll just go take a 10-minute walk and make a point of taking two cool pictures of something. I'm learning all the streets instead of, I'll get stressed out. I just need air. I would take a smoke break or something. Instead of that, I'm walking around, exploring, and looking it up, and kind of, seeing things again. Yeah, that was kind of a weird segue from why we do this, but
It's kind of on the same page, I guess. Sometimes you gotta use stupid old stories, but yeah, I did the same thing back at this one company. I worked with a guy, and every day around 4 p.m., I'd say, yes. take a break. Let's go for a walk. And this little tech area where our business was had a nice little sidewalk path around, little creek next to that, and you could see the mountains, blah, blah, blah. It was great. And looking back on it, I was talking to him years later. He said, man, that was some of my favorite times working there. It was just those walks we'd take. Because he'd come up with so much creative stuff. Like, we designed an entire game and made it just from walking around, talking about stuff. Just let your get away from your PC, get some creative juices going, detach yourself, and just have a good chat with a friend.
Yeah. Yeah. It's therapeutic. It's a good thing to do. Like, the older I get, the more I realize, like, my ability to, you know, be good at my job and be good at work is my time away and my time not working, my time, like, relaxing and doing other stuff and being interested in other things is almost equally important to me actually doing my job.
Yeah, the value of living your life really increases the older you get, I've noticed. I mean, I'm over 35 now, and I've changed so many things just in the last year. I mean, everybody knows I like to work out, but now I spend like at least an hour a day just stretching. I stretched before, but now I'm like really into it, and I've gotten so much better at a lot of things, just from like moving around things that I just never really thought about it as much as I should have, I guess. You know, you read articles like, oh, I just got to do bench press and squats and deadlifts, but the big thing now is what they call prehab instead of rehab. It's like you do all the exercises or massages, muscle therapy, thing like that before you're injured. And it actually leads more to injury prevention. And of course, as you get older, your body just starts falling apart anyway. When you're young, you're invincible. Oh, I can do whatever all the time. But you're not. Your body, you're just destroying yourself and don't know it. Now, like I said, as I get older, it's just, I'm focused. My workout is completely focused on 100% mobility. As in, not like I'm training for a sport. Everything I do is just to make getting out of the bed easier. Standing up, walking around, like, you know, like when you're helping out somebody who's a little older and they can't even bend over to do something. And that's a it's going to happen to us all, so you might as well prep for it. Maybe get some muscles in place that'll hold your body together maybe a little longer. I mean, I've never had a shoulder injury, never had any shoulder problems. My shoulders never hurt. But I've been doing rotator cuff exercises for years because I read a long time ago about a guy who was a trainer that was a little bit older. That's what they said. Just protect your shoulders, protect your knees. And that's just what I do. It's not like impressive, cool lifting or anything like that. It's just perfect form, precision, stretching, etc. Yeah, that's just the way I live enough now.
No, it's awesome. Like, I mean, ever since I've known you, you've had like a new type of body project, right? Few years. I remember you did go straight up bodybuilding, and then you went to bodyweight exercises, and then you did foot bag and juggling and other, just sort of like...
Oh, yeah. I get into like powerlifting, get into Olympic lifting, whatever. It's a lot of fun, but...
Yeah. Log tossing.
What's that?
Log tossing.
Yeah, log tossing. Was that caber toss? What they call it?
Probably.
Yeah, I love watching those strongman competitions. Those guys are ridiculous. I'll never be like that, but it's fun to watch what the human body can do.
Can and probably shouldn't. Yeah. Although, you know, if you ever need to like assemble a log cabin by throwing them, then I know just the guys to call.
Yeah, I follow them on Twitter. It's weird. I've noticed a lot of animators are really big into like proper exercise and stuff. Like they seem to, it seems like animators who know more about the way the body moves get into that. Just maybe it's just my perspective of just animators I've known, but it seems like a lot of animators enjoy that.
Oh yeah, I've seen the same thing. I worked with a guy at Vigil. He was their lead animator, awesome guy named Chad. He was just like super fit, buff dude, and he was the lead animator on Darksiders and or Darksiders 2 and possibly Darksiders 1. Crazy talented guy and just like really physically fit and just attuned. And the animation of that game is just absolutely insanely bar none.
Yeah, the you're talking about like I do all kinds of different crap. My latest one about mobility. I started just kind of looking up how the body moves and what you need to do. And what actually was the most fascinating and I got the most info from was infant development. Like when a baby is born, they're completely, like, they can't do anything. They can just lay there and drink milk. But the first thing they have to do is develop neck strength just so they can hold their own head up. Like a baby can't hold its own head. I don't know if you know this about children, but you have to hold a baby. You have to hold its head because it can't hold its head up. So the first major muscle it develops is around the neck just so it can hold its own head up. And then it's like little things that it has to learn to roll over onto its stomach or and kind of do like a little like a push-up kind of sit-up thing. Then eventually crawl. Eventually, sitting. Sitting is the thing that has to learn how to do. Because you see like, you can find videos of this of like a baby. Like they'll set him up and the baby just falls over and laughs because it thinks it's funny because it can't sit up. That's just, it's those little things. And I realized that, okay, well then when you get older, all that, it goes back the other direction. You start losing ability to do stuff. Like what happens to a lot of older folks is they'll take a tumble, they'll fall down, and they'll never be able to recover from it. Like the Alice from Brady Bunch that just died. Mm-hmm. She slipped and fell in the bathroom and hit her head.
Oh.
And just never recovered from it. And that was it. So, and it got me thinking back to wrestling training. You have to train your neck a lot to tuck your chin. If you don't tuck your chin when you fall, you hit your head on the mat. You can knock yourself out. And like I said, like she hit her head. And I'm not saying that if she was in shape, she'd been fine. No, it's none of that. But it's a little thing that if your neck is weaker and you fall, you're not going to be able to hold your head. It's going to whip back and knock yourself silly. Those weird little things. I think that's how my brain works. That's what I think about all day long. Is falling down and hitting my head.
and how if Alice and the Brady Bunch had been, you know, like ripped, she would have been totally fine.
She should have been powerlifting. She'd have been fine. She'd live to be 190
and a half.
As off topic as all that is. Yeah, you know, honestly, I think we could put a nice bit of info in here. If you want to, we could wrap now.
I think I'm good. I've been up since 5:30.
Yeah, it's getting late for you at this point. And I've got soup I'm trying to cook in there.
All right, cool deal. No, it's good to be back. This is like totally therapeutic for me.
Yes, that's the word I was going to use. Therapeutic. So awesome. Well, thanks for coming back. And
huzzah.
Huzzah to that. Well, we're going to try to get back in regular motion, but we still have all those crunch bites. We kind of, you know, the process of game development thing we're doing, and it took a bit of a hiatus. There's just been a lot of things going on, a lot of people's lives. I don't know. If you know Jesse Sosa, who's one of our regulars, if you follow him on Facebook, you know he just went to Brazil for a while to do a job down there. It's like, it's so hard to get everybody together all the time, but we do what we can. So yeah, anything you want to follow up with or promote?
Nah.
Cool. Well then, with that, I'll just wrap it up then. All right.
All right. Awesome. Thanks, everybody.